There's two astonishing new AI-powered tools in Photoshop, Generative Fill and the Remove tool. We're going to look at the similarities, we're going to look at the differences, but then we're also going to examine different types of images, and you're going to find out sometimes one tool excels over the other in different scenarios. Let's start with the Remove tool. Check out my previous tutorial on the Remove tool when it was in beta. Right now, it's released in the full version of Photoshop. You'll see I'm using the beta right now because I also want to have access to Generative Fill. So if you go under the Spot Healing brush, you'll see the Remove tool. Let's make the brush a little bit bigger. And here's a big tip. Before you use it, create a new layer. This way it's going to work non-destructively. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn off Remove After Each Stroke. And this is going to enable me just to paint over the entire object that I want to remove. So let's just paint over it loosely. Left bracket key will make that brush a little bit smaller. Let's go over that section there and grab the handlebars. And because we turned off Remove After Each Stroke, it will enact when I hit the check mark. And you'll see it's done a pretty good job. Now, some people will be commenting about the shadow. No problem. Let's turn Remove After Each Stroke on. And I'm just going to paint across the shadow. And let's get rid of it. Now, if you see some areas where it's soft, it's not because of resolution. Let's paint. And notice it will fill it with full resolution. And you can clean up edges just by painting over them like I have here. Now, before we compare the two, let's have a look at Generative Fill. So we're going to grab the lasso tool and let's just make a rough selection around this vehicle, and we'll also include the shadow. Now, as I've demonstrated in my previous videos, to remove an object, you click on Generative Fill and then you choose Generate. Now this goes up to the cloud where it processes it and it works in the data center and then it sends it back. So a good internet connection is really important. And look at this, does a pretty good job. Now it creates a new layer so we can look at it before and after. Notice it has generated some interesting things here in the background. And if you're getting any value out of this video, hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. All right, that's what both the tools do. And that's where the similarities end. Let's jump in and look at them in more detail in specific projects. This particular one, we're going to look at replacing a very large area in a photo. And why don't we start with Generative Fill? So I'm just going to make a selection around it. And it doesn't have to be a perfect selection. You can use the selection tools to help if you wish. And let's replace this by hitting Generative Fill and then Generate. Now, I'm not going to try and make any of this look perfect. We're going to look under the hood. We're going to closely examine things and see the strengths and weaknesses inside of these tools for real. All right. That actually did a pretty good job. So I'm just going to hide this for now. And what we're going to do now, we're going to use the Remove tool, and then we're going to closely examine these. So let's create a new layer. And why don't we grab our Remove tool here? I'm going to grab a larger brush and let's just paint over the area. I have Remove Each Stroke turned on, but I just won't release my mouse until I've finished painting over the entire area. Once again, I could use selection tools to help me. But in this case, we're not going to bother. I'm going to release and let it do its thing. Now, one of the things you'll notice, though, is the Remove tool works a lot faster because it doesn't have to load onto the cloud. What it actually does is it uses a lightweight version of the model locally. So you don't need to be connected to the internet to use the Remove tool. That's one of the big differences. The second difference, let's zoom in here. I'm just going to double click to go into 100%. Now, if we look at this, we can see, yes, the replacement's not perfect. We'll look at that in a moment, but look at the resolution. It's the same resolution as the rest of the image. Yes, this is hilarious. We'll fix those. If we look at Generative Fill, notice that this is low resolution. So Generative Fill is limited to 1024 by 1024 squares as far as its resolution. Now, this will probably change in the future, but it's just something to be aware of. So for large areas, we've got to consider that resolution. Now, we can get around that by sampling smaller areas, and I've done another tutorial. You probably want to check my whole playlist on this. All right, so if we look at generative fill, you know, apart from the resolution, it's done a pretty good job of replacing the background. Now, there's some areas there you might want to apply a second pass. So one of the challenges of the remove tool when we're working on a large area is sometimes it can be very repetitive with details. So let's go in here and we look and we see we've got some interesting kind of things going on here. It's not bad on this particular image, however, but see, we've got a little repetition there, so we can go in here and just kind of touch it up just by painting over it. And then some other times you'll get some weird things like that that you would just paint over. So if we want to get rid of that, we could. So the nice thing about this tool, notice the strength of it is when it comes down to doing details. It really, really shines on small areas. Let's see if we can fix this bridge. Notice how it just rebuilt that rail. Let's go to a different scenario. Notice this little camera shake on here, so it's not a perfect photo. But we're not worried about that. What we want to do is get rid of this tower. So why don't we start with the remove tool? Let's create a new layer, and we're going to grab our remove tool. I'm going to hit the left bracket key, make it a little bit smaller. Now, here's a tip for working in this. Sometimes you want to work in similar areas at the same time. So we're going to go over this tower here, and we're just going to release, let it do its magic. And now we can just kind of go back over it and touch it up. So sometimes you don't necessarily get this one working all in a single pass. Now, for things like getting rid of power lines, this thing is really good. Notice it excels in things like power lines. Okay, so for the small stuff, once again, forget the doubling up. This is not a great photo, but it's a good example of cleaning up. Look at this. We can just go in here and start to clean up these areas. All right, here's a moment of truth. How is it going to do through a semi-transparent object like this veil? Let's try. Look at that. It's like magic. All right, and if we zoom out and we look at this before and after, notice it can quite easily handle this very, very difficult object even behind a semi-transparent area. Did they hang that on the tree? That's a good little trick. All right, let's see how generative fill works with this. So why don't we grab our lasso tool and we'll just start with this area up the top. Let's not worry about trying to do it in one hit because that wouldn't be fair. We're going to hit generative fill and we're going to hit generate. And whoops, what it's done is it's actually just given us different masts instead of removing them. Okay, we'll add a prompt. We'll do sky. What do we got? Let's look at the options. Yeah, it's clearly not working very well in this particular scenario. Well, let's see how it does with transparency. We'll forget about all that mess up there. And let's see, how does it do with trying to get rid of the transparency behind here? Let's hit generate fill. Okay, that's not bad. Let's look at the other options, the second variation, the third variation. It's kind of getting there. It's definitely better than it was. So, you know, a couple more passes, I might be able to get it. So I think we can see in this situation, the remove tool actually is working better than generative fill. Why don't we see if we can get rid of the lady and then all this mess over here. So I'm going to start generative. Let's make a selection. And I could probably just use select subject and expand it, but this is fine. We'll make a selection here and then we're going to hit generative fill. And we'll see how this does with the woman in the umbrella. Pretty good. Yeah, that is pretty good. We'll look at the second variation, third variation. I might even go for the second variation. Yeah, that works well. Now let's try this same thing with the remove tool. So we're going to grab our remove tool, create a new layer. By the way, when it's on, make sure sample all layers is on or it's not going to work. So if it's not working for you, that's why. I'm hitting the right bracket key to make the brush bigger. And let's paint over that part of the umbrella. Left bracket key, make the brush smaller. And I've got remove each stroke turned on. So I'm going to have to get a little wider on the feet than I normally would. And not bad. I mean, the background here is pretty distorted and a little bit weird, but maybe we can kind of touch it up. Sort of. Yeah. We're sort of rebuilding this building. You know. So what it's doing, because it doesn't have access to the entire generative model, it's not able to reproduce things like buildings and complex backgrounds as easily as the generative fill. So I would say for this scenario here, I feel like generative fill did a better job. Why don't we start with generative fill? I think the blonde lady kind of peeping in here is a little bit distracting, and also she stole someone else's lunch, so she's not friends anymore, so we're going to get rid of her. All right, so we've got that. We're going to hit generative fill, and we're going to hit generate. All right, whoopsie. Looks like we've got somebody else in here instead. Okay, so if we look at the variations here, rather than getting rid of the person, it's just given us an additional person. That's one of the quirks of generative fill. It doesn't always replace the object with the background. Sometimes it replaces it with another object. You can use prompts sometimes to get around it, but let's have a look and see how the remove tool does instead. So let me create a new layer. All right, let's grab our remove tool. And this time I'm going to remove after each stroke. I'm going to turn it off. All right, let's just paint over her face. Left bracket key makes that brush a little bit smaller, and then we'll go down here, trying not to go into the face of the other woman too much here. It's a little bit forgiving, but it's not overly forgiving if you go too far. All right, let's apply this. And pop. Now it's a good time to turn on remove after each stroke, and we can just quickly go through here. One of the things this just excels in is getting these little areas. Let's just clean that area up. Okay, so as you can see there, it's not perfect. A little bit of work, we could definitely make it perfect. And clearly, in this particular scenario here, the remove tool worked a lot better than the generative fill. All right, let's go back to this image here. And what we're gonna do is get rid of all this mess on the right-hand side. So why don't we grab our lasso tool, and I'm just gonna paint around it, go here, select that area, and now we're going to hit generative fill and then hit generate. I think that did an exceptionally good job on this more complex image. Let's hide that for a second and see how the remove tool does on this. Let's create a new layer. Let's grab the remove tool. And what I'm going to do this time is I'm just going to do it incrementally, because sometimes it gets better results when you allow it to sample a smaller area, where things are more similar. Okay, as you can see, for a little bit of work, we can sort of start to get there using the remove tool. But clearly, the winner for this kind of stuff is generative fill. So what is the solution? The solution is actually to use both tools. I like to use generative fill when we've got larger areas where we've got complex backgrounds behind them. But then we can come in with the remove tool and we can remove small objects like that car. Or we want to get rid of this pole. Okay, so the strengths in the remove tool seem to be when it's got a simpler background, when you're working in smaller areas, you want to have manual control over the retouching. Now, the other advantage, of course, is speed. It's much faster. You don't have to have an internet connection. You get high resolution and it's in the main shipping version of Photoshop, so it's ready for commercial purposes. Now, of course, the advantages of generative fill, of course, you know, outside from outcropping and generating objects, just when we're talking about removal, it does really well when it's got complex backgrounds because it has a larger model which is trained on a lot more objects. It's able to generate more complex objects for the background. So it does well in those scenarios such as like cities and areas where there's more unique details. So let me know in the comments underneath, which tool do you think did best and which one do you think is going to be the winner in the long term? Or are you going to be like me and use both of them? I'm going to link to some of the other tutorials that I mentioned in this video, particularly the remove tool and my generative fill video. And I'll put those links somewhere around here and also in the comments. And if you haven't followed me, hit the subscribe button, turn on notifications, and you won't miss any of my future tutorials that I'm going to be putting out. Until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.